Rahman Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. Good afternoon. And welcome to this session. This is the this is a session looking at developing a halal ecosystem, particularly looking at new markets. And I'll begin by just briefly introducing our panelists, and then we will hear from them one by one, with around 10 minutes for each speaker. And then we will have some questions and some comments among ourselves, and we'll open the floor up for questions from the audience as well. So just to introduce our speakers, on my left, we have Dr. Cedomir Nestorovic, the professor for the management department of the ESAC Business School, Asia Pacific. He's based in the Republic of Singapore. And then we have Javier Santiso, who is the executive director of investments and the head of Khazana in Europe. And then we have Marcus Jank, vice president of corporate affairs and business development, BRF, large Brazilian corporation, but he is now based in the Republic of Singapore as well. And then we have Hyunju, Madison Shin, global regulatory affairs manager from the Daesang Corporation from the Republic of Korea. And people always say that we have a panel of distinguished speakers, but we really do have a panel of distinguished speakers. We've just been in the green room behind, and we've been kind of comparing notes and looking at the kind of topics that we're going to discuss, and we've got some we've got a good panel for you this afternoon. I want to just give a little bit of context before we hear from any of our speakers, just to have a sense of what has happened with halal as a defining market parameter over the past, well, say over the past 20 years. Because if you go back, halal used to be just about how you slaughtered an animal. And it really didn't go much further than that. And that had been the case for a very long time. But as halal evolved, we found that halal was not just referring to a slaughter process, it was not just referring to meat, it was the halal also encompassed non-meat foods, and then also went out past the food market into cosmetics and personal care and pharmaceuticals and other products that you would consume or put on your skin. But it also did not stop there. And the idea of a halal market that also encompassed the tourism industry with hotels and hospitality, and also the whole kind of tourism industry, but also the fashion industry, and also aspects that relate more to the digital economy and the online economy. All of these elements are now really encompassed with inside this idea of a halal ecosystem. But an ecosystem is also not the same thing as a market. And with an ecosystem, there are issues to do with regulatory frameworks, and issues of to what extent the government needs to be involved, and matters like this. How much is it to do with the private sector? How much does the public sector need to be involved? How much do policy decisions affect the success of the private sector? And these are also some of the issues that we'll be looking at today. Just to give you a little bit of size, in terms of the size of the market, just looking at the food and beverage industry, rather than trying to size the whole thing, but the food and beverage consumption of the Muslim world has been estimated at $1.37 trillion. This was from a Thomson Reuters publication recently. And to give you context for that, if that was a single block, that would be the largest in the world, because the next biggest market is China at $857 billion, and after that, the United States is $768 billion. So you can see the Muslim market for food and beverage is significant. And if we then add in all of the other elements, I think the travel sector has also been estimated over 100 billion. Fashion is getting up there. Pharmaceuticals also getting, you know, well into the tens of billions. So as an ecosystem, we're talking about something which is a significant size, which I think has not yet reached its full potential. I'm going to ask Dr. Cedomir to come and speak first, and he'll give us a sense of what he understands by the term ecosystem from an academic perspective. Dr. Cedomir, please.
Hello. Thank you, Abdalhamid. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's always dangerous to give the floor to a professor. You know when he starts.
If you go too far, I will try and stop you.
So we'll try to keep in with the 10 minutes. So I'm coming from a business school. We are a French business school, but we are now located in Singapore for the last 7 years. So if you have the opportunity to go to Singapore, please, we are welcome, and you can come to see us. Concerning the topic for today, we have been discussing about the ecosystem. So I will try to see what, from my point of view, the ecosystem here is. The ecosystem is a comprehensive set of elements which will help the halal industry. So in that case, we obviously have the finance element. Without the finance, we cannot invest. We have the production element. If you don't have pastries, if you don't have cattle, if you don't have land, it's very difficult to produce something which is halal. And finally, we have the human capital, that is people who are ready to produce and who are ready to engage in that. But the main thing is the market. If there is no market, in that case, it's useless to talk about that. So I will go back to what our moderator, Abdalhamid, was just mentioning. Of course, if we take the total consumption of food and beverages, which is consumed in Muslim countries, it is a very huge one. And bigger than the United States, bigger than China, as you already mentioned. But the problem is that the halal section of it represents less than 50%. And the halal certified section is a fraction of that. So it means that there are still many opportunities concerning the halal food, even in Muslim countries, and especially for the halal certified products. Now, the Muslim countries by themselves are relatively poor compared to the rest of the world. If we consider, for instance, that the Muslim population today represents about 22% of total population, the total GDP which is coming from Muslim countries, that is from OIC countries, represents only 8.3% of total GDP. So it means that there is a huge discrepancy between what the Muslim population represents and what the GDP represents. Of course, the GDP is not the only and the most perfect indicator, but this is the indicator that we have today and everyone is using it. If you look at the classification which is given by the World Bank, about 26 countries from the OIC are in the low-income group, and 25 of them are in the middle-income group, and only 6 of them are in the high-income group. So if we look at value-added products, if we look at sophisticated products, automatically we are coming to the conclusion that the Muslim countries, that is OIC countries, do not represent a very bright area where to go. So this is what we get when we look only at the figures, and I will refer to something that His Excellency Mohammed Ali from IDB was mentioning, that 90% of displaced persons today are coming from Muslim countries. So this is an additional burden concerning the estimation of the total halal market that we may have. So, concerning the market, this could be seen as, I would say, not encouraging element, but we'll see after that some other opportunities which are much brighter. The opportunities are the following ones, especially when we talk about new markets. If we talk about Western markets, now we have second and third generation of Muslims living there. They enjoy the average purchasing power that all other people can enjoy within a country such as France, UK, or somewhere else. It means that they have the purchasing power, and they are looking to the sophistication of products that we can have for the other markets. Of course, in the past, we used to sell staple products, that is, basic products out of which you are preparing your meal. This was for the first generation. But the second and third generation, they want to buy already ready meals. So the already ready meals is the opportunity that we can think about, and not only to sell staple products. This is why many international companies and multinational companies are entering this market. The second opportunity is something which has been mentioned before concerning the Islamic Finance Panel when they were talking about the other term, which is the Tayyib term. So the Tayyib term, which is referring to everything which is organic, which is, for instance, non-hormone products, which is human products. All these products are today on the bright increase concerning Western markets. And Halal has this opportunity to be presented also as a Tayyib product and automatically have some advantage over the competitors who cannot enjoy this kind of qualification. So if there is an opportunity which is practically ready for Halal manufacturers, it is to put the emphasis on Tayyib and not necessarily on Halal. The term Halal is very often conceived as a religious term. So as you know, in Western markets, everything which is associated with Islam is considered problematic. So in that case, if they are switching to the term Tayyib, probably this is a more neutral term. We don't talk about the religiosity, and we talk only about the quality of the product. And probably this will have a better impact on non-Muslim populations. The third opportunity is that today we don't have one big player that is one champion of Halal. Of course, Nestle is there. Of course, Coca-Cola is there. Of course, Danone is there. But they are not pure players. So it means that today, for a company which has the ambition and, of course, has the capacities, there is an avenue for entering the market because there is no big player existing today. So there are three opportunities that I see here, and some companies and some areas have already engaged in this. I would just mention the case of Brunei, which is present in UK, and they want to produce in UK and sell in UK. So it meaning not sending products coming from Brunei or somewhere else, but they will cut everything in UK, package in UK, and distribute in UK. The second example, also coming from Brunei, is the arrangement that they have in Guangxi area in China, where they are setting up three companies, and one of them will only do halal food, because in Brunei they don't have so much land, they don't have so much cattle, so they are going to China in order to do everything, and they control everything. On the other side, in Dubai, they are also launching a very ambitious program concerning halal industry. Apart from the certification process, they are attracting multinational companies in order to package and especially to add some value to the products in Dubai and to export from Dubai somewhere else. These are the possibilities that everyone is looking at in order to see what may happen in the future. To finish, I will look at the question what to do now, because if we look at the ecosystem that I mentioned before, we need money, we need human capital, we need production and market. So on the term of finance, the problem is the following one. As it was mentioned before, the Islamic finance is progressing at a rate of about 17% per year. This is spectacular, even if Islamic finance represents only a fraction of conventional finance. But 17% per year, everyone will look at this. And the fact is that halal food is progressing at, let's say, 4 to 5% per year. So there is a huge disbalance between the progress of Islamic finance and the progress of halal food. Up to now, I didn't see many initiatives that people and institutions are launching sukuk, which will help the halal industry. We have everything, helping tourism, helping industry, that is manufacturing, services, but concerning halal industry, we don't have so many. So the question is, if we want to develop the halal industry, where is the money coming from? Will it come from the government sources? Will it come from the private sources? And in private sources, we don't have too much appetite in order to invest in the halal industry. One reason is that the halal industry is extremely fragmented. Here we are talking very much about SMEs, and it is sure that it is in the SMEs that we have many halal companies, and the big players in Islamic finance, would it be pure Islamic finance or even conventional finance, when you tell them that you need $50,000 to develop something, nobody is listening to you. So maybe we would need some Grameen Bank from Muhammad Yunus just to invest in microfinance concerning halal industry, because so far the SMEs are not helped when we look at that. Finally, concerning the human capital, so far we have an extremely high number of courses, universities, and degrees concerning Islamic finance. But concerning halal, there are not so many. So in that case, the question is, will we have enough specialists in this domain, while on the other side, concerning Islamic finance, we have thousands of people who complete their education and they become specialists in Islamic finance. So today, in order to develop, in order to improve this, I would say that the first element is financing and support concerning SMEs which are engaged in halal business. Without them, there could be hardly an improvement concerning the sector. At the same time, there should be also an investment concerning the human capital, that is education and training. It was mentioned before this morning that research is a primary element. I would just add that training is also an additional element concerning this, because so far we have various interpretations about this halal, and we usually have some boundaries between the schools of fiqh or between the interpretations of halal, mainly due to the fact that people practically don't know what is happening in other jurisdictions. So far from my side, so I hope that we can discuss about all this later on. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Cedomir. Some interesting points there. I mean, there was a nice analysis of what the elements that you need for an ecosystem in terms of market demand, production, people, human resources, and of course money, and where will the money come from for the expansion of the halal, well, the food sector, but also of the other halal-related sectors, is also an issue. And I think there's quite a few points here which we can pick up on when we come to have a discussion. I've got a few questions for you already. But we will go on to our next speaker, and I'm going to ask Hyunju Shin from Korea, from the Daesan Corporation, to come and give us her presentation. And I think you have some slides to operate as well, yes. So let's give her a welcoming round in Malaysia. Have we got slides? Is there a technician in the house?
There we go, yeah.
Yes.
Hello everyone, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Hyunju Shin from Daesan Corporation in Korea. And truly it's my great honor to be here and speak about the Korean halal industry on behalf of my country, Korea, and my company, Daesan Corporation. So let me first introduce my company, Daesan Corporation. Daesan Corporation is number one leading food manufacturing company in Korea, and it was established in 1956 based on its own biofermentation technology. And my company is also very famous for the first company in Korea that established a foreign manufacturing plant in abroad. It was in 1973, we established PT Miwon in Indonesia. and our business in Indonesia got very successful. And as you know, Indonesia has the biggest Muslim population in the world. So this is how my company has become aware of the importance of halal to enter the global market early 70s. So now we do have 14 food products, halal food products, including seaweed, mayonnaise, cooking oils, snacks, and noodles, etc., and 70 bio halal products. And they are certified by Indonesia MUI or KMF, which is Korean Halal Certificate Body. I'm not going to talk about the global halal market in detail because we all know the global halal market is huge and it's developing very fast. And there is so much potential to even grow more and bigger. So we all know halal food market is one of the fastest growing markets in the world, and I believe no one can really deny this. Korea also sees the global halal market is very attractive. So halal food has been a significant focus area for Korea this year. Our President Park actually singled out halal as a priority for her government in her New Year's message by mentioning that the government will foster agriculture as an export industry so that using free trade agreements as a stepping stone, our farm produce can go beyond China and Southeast Asian countries to reach halal food markets too. Also, during her visit to UAE in March, Korea signs MOU with UAE for halal. And following her returns, our government has started establishing schemes to promote the industry in many ways, and plans for halal food industry development and export was announced in June. So let me introduce the halal certificate body in Korea, which is KMF. KMF stands for Korea Muslim Federation. KMF currently has cross accreditation with Malaysia JAKIM and other cross accreditation with Indonesia, UAE, Singapore are underway. According to my reference, KMF has certified 155 producers, 524 products, and 6 restaurants so far. And this green logo shows the KMF official halal logo, and the picture shows the KMF central mosque located in Seoul. So as I just mentioned, 155 food companies and 524 products have the KMF halal certificate, and 14 companies and 264 products certified by foreign bodies. And the table also shows the number of companies in top 10 countries halal certified by MUI. And as you can see, the Korea is ranked by 5th place, and MUI also mentioned that Korea has become one of the most aggressive countries in halal market. So this year, 2015, Korea's total agri-food products export in halal markets is increased by 0.8% compared to the same period of last year, 2014. Nevertheless, all these political and social support, there's still the major limitation, which is halal products are limited to a few items such as cooking oil, seaweed, kimchi, cooked rice, noodles. And from these examples, you may guess that these products have relatively a small number of ingredients. So we need to expand halal to other processed food products, especially including Korean traditional sauce products. So here I pointed out 4 challenges, and the first one is investment in R&D. As I just mentioned, it's important to have halal certificate for the Korean traditional sauces because these Korean traditional sauces are really widely used as an ingredient to other products. However, since these products are fermented food products, the alcohol is naturally produced during the fermentation process. So develop alcohol reduction techniques in Korean traditional fermented foods are very important. And the second one is investments in plants. Since the halal requires dedicated lines and equipment, it costs lots of money and it's not easy to handle them in plants. The third one is limited cross-certification between KMF and other certificate bodies overseas. cross-certification is only available with Malaysia JAKIM. So I think KMF needs to expand cross-certification with other countries to develop the Korean halal industry. And the fourth one is, the last one is consumer education and communication. And I think this is the most important thing for non-Islamic countries like Korea. Because we don't want our consumer to think halal is something that is only consumed by Muslims. As you know, non-Muslims are increasingly interested in halal food products because of its safety and cleanliness and good quality. So I think it's really important to educate and communicate with consumers halal as a safe and clean food so that everyone can enjoy halal food regardless their religious backgrounds. So thank you very much. And if you have any questions, you can ask me later. And thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Hyunju. I'm just reflecting on the whole reality of Korea entering the halal market, because a few years ago, I don't think we would have seen something quite like this. I remember when we held the first World Halal Forum here in 2006, someone from Korea came to the World Halal Forum, and I remember asking him, wow, Korea, what are you doing at the World Halal Forum? And he was saying, well, you know, it's something that we're thinking about. We think this may be an interesting opportunity. And whether that person was actually involved in the development of it is irrelevant, really. What we now see is that $860 million a year in halal food product exports for Korea, really in a very short period of time. And I think also what we see from this is that by simply looking at halal and the halal market and the halal ecosystem, looking at it as a business opportunity, you can cut through a lot of the complications that the Muslim majority countries get caught up in, and also that some of the Western Muslim minority countries, where they tend to look at the Muslim population as being more of a problem rather than an opportunity, whereas Korea has simply seen a business opportunity and they pursued it. And I think there's a very interesting case study there in terms of what they've done. And I also will have some questions for you later on. But we're going to move on, and we're going to move past food and look at other areas of the halal ecosystem. And I'm going to ask Javier Santiso to come and give some words to the or you can do it.
I will do it from here. I
mean, please, however easier. You're comfortable.
The idea is, I understand, also to have a conversation. So.
Absolutely, yes.
So
yes.
I have 10 minutes, and I don't want to abuse, obviously, of the time. I want to share three ideas with you, which maybe to bring a different angle. First, I'm very interested. I was listening with very interesting presentation on Korea. Korea is an amazing country. I'm a great fan of Korea because they are in the edge of many, many things. And my first comment is on the internet industrial revolution, so the digital revolution. They are in the edge of that. But for someone coming from Spain, where we were supposed to be the number one worldwide in olive, and to see that there's a Korean company producing, exporting halal certified olive oil, this is, I mean, also being in the edge. It's yes. To understand the global tectonics, the global shifts. So I'm, again, very, very happy to come just after Korea. I will share also some thoughts on Spain. But my first comment is precisely on this industrial digital revolution. So we have been talking during the day. I heard some of the presentations just before. This it became a buzzword. You know, now we talk about disruption, disruptors, entrepreneurs, and this is the big words that we are listening. But it's just to put in perspective what is going on. And here also it's to see a world of opportunities, and all world opportunities also maybe for the halal economy. So basically the big numbers, during 500 years over the last century, so from 1300 to till 1800, so till the Industrial Revolution in UK, the GDP per capita worldwide has been flat. So there was no wealth of nation. That's why, by the way, Adam Smith was obsessed with the wealth of nations. By the way, the country that he had in mind when he was writing the wealth of nations was an Asian one. It was already China. Okay, so it was in toward this part of the world that he was looking at. But the point is that during 500 years, the GDP per capita worldwide remains flat. And the multiplier, so the multiplier was 1.1, and suddenly the multipliers start jumping. 1.5, the Industrial Revolution, and we reach levels of 2 of the multiplier worldwide since we have been seeing the digital computer revolution. And now we are at the level of 2.5, I mean, whatever economist projections is reliable. 2.5 is this new wave, is the Industrial Revolution. And this is catching up worldwide. I mean, the world of yesterday, in terms of innovation and technology, is the world that was centered in the US. It's Palo Alto. Palo Alto is still there. Palo Alto generates the biggest unicorns, these amazing 1 billion worth companies. This is true. But you have unicorns now spreading all over the world. So you have very, very high level of growth of internet disruptive companies coming from everywhere, including Europe. There's 40 unicorns, so one out of five now that is coming from Europe. Every month there's a unicorn born in Europe, the continent where I'm based. But you have unicorns in Russia, you have unicorns in India, in China, from Southeast Asia, we will see from the Middle East, etc. So this is catching up, and it's all the sectors. So if you are in the food industry, you will see unicorns coming, and they will go to eat your cake if you don't take care. If you are in the hotel industry, you will see unicorns that are already there. It's Airbnb, so that they are eating the cake of the intercontinental of the world, with zero rooms, zero hotels, and intercontinental has 400,000 hotels. And today, Uber is worth 4 times more than Intercontinental. So just to give what is going on. So what I'm saying that, and it's to end with my first comment, is precisely that there's also space for Halal 3.0, which is this internet digitalization wave, and that is touching sectors where the Halal economy is very important. We already gave some numbers. I will give some additional ones in food and tech, travel and tech, fin and tech, so you can pursue everything related to finance and technology, food and technology, travel and technology. And just as an example, there's two companies, internet companies, that are specialized in trips, halal trips, so halal bookings. One is called halalbooking.com. They are in London, London-based Turkish founders, that they create in a niche market booking systems for certified halal hotels and places where you can go. The same halal trip, this one is in Singapore, it's based in Singapore. So you have startups that are already popping up from the halal economy. And there, we will see more because, and this is my second comment, we already mentioned that, it's a big market. So, and we are pretty blind, maybe the Europeans, not to see it. I mean, it's Korean, Brazilian companies that we will be listening today. And maybe in Europe we are pretty blind not to see it for many, many, many reasons. But the Muslim population is 1.5 billion, so it's 25% of the total population, just to give a number. In 2030, it will be more than 2.2 billion, which is, will be nearly 30% of the total worldwide population. So if you look at consumer markets, tourism, food, etc., I mean, you should catch... Take note of the numbers, and the dynamics are there because it's also very, very dynamic. If you take the top 10 of the 13 emerging markets that have large, the top 30 emerging markets, you have 10 that are Muslim with the big Muslim populations, one out of three. And obviously you have big Muslim populations in Western countries, in the US, 8 million, in France, 6 million, so I mean you can with the power of acquisition. In India, 140 million, in China, 40 million. I mean, it's not only the Muslims countries, there's all over, the spread is pretty large. If you go to Islamic finance, it's the same. It's a big market. And here, Malaysia, I think, has a unique place. I was looking at the rankings of the global Islamic economic indicators. Malaysia is number one, ahead of Emirates, ahead of any other countries. If you look at the sukuks, Malaysia is number one. This is very interesting. I'm dreaming someday that we will see an Al-Andalusi bone sukuk coming from Spain. So that would be great. So maybe we'll have to think about it, and the Spaniards and the Malays. But this is a big, big also opportunity to size. And obviously, when we talk about the internet, internet is also disrupting finance and tech. So it's to think also about systems from peer-to-peer lending. I mean, you can do many, many things also in this space. And I haven't seen a halal fintech company that is sizing this market. Mm. Third comment, I'm coming from Spain, so you know the journey is Korea, Spain, and we will talk maybe about Brazil. I want to take the example of Spain as maybe a missed opportunity. So, and why Spain or Europe, let's say, we should think twice about the halal opportunities. Obviously, the numbers are there, I already commented. But if you think about Spain, we had 700 years of history common with the Muslim Arab world. 700 years. So for the ones that went to Spain, you just have to walk in Granada and you will see the Alhambra. You walk in Cordoba, you see the Mezquita. These are cities that are very, very embedded in the history. And a lot of words in Spanish sounds like Arabic. We say ojalá. This is one of the most known expressions in Spain, ojalá, inshallah, so etc. Well, there was nearly till now, and I have a friend here in the room and friends that have been pushing for certifying hotels in Spain, and the first one was in Marbella. And it's very interesting, the story of this hotel, because it was a big hotel chain, Spanish, very well known in Europe, very, very big worldwide, that was the owner of the hotel. And it was an hotel that was, because it was just in front of two five-star hotels, that was languishing. But the hotel was placed in a very unique place. Marbella, south of Spain, is very, very well known in the Middle East. Saudis, Kuwaitis, Emiratis, all want to go. The King Abdullah was flying over there always, and a lot of people going. So some very clever Saudi investor realized that this hotel was nearly empty, and it was just nearby the mosque. There's a mosque built by the Saudis at 5 minutes walks of the hotel. So it was certified halal, and now it's full, it's packed. I mean, you need nearly to book in advance to go to the hotel. There's every day nearly 500 Muslims going to the Alhambra in Granada. So every day. There's zero halal hotel, zero restaurant, halal certified restaurant in Granada. So maybe we should think twice, at least the Spaniards, a bit more, or maybe investors that want to do things in these amazing cities of the south of Spain. And I want to give an example of a chef, and I finish with this, but if you allow me a couple of more minutes.
Yeah, no, go.
Just to illustrate, I have nothing to sell. I have no food products, etc., but I'm a foodie. So I love food. I think that chefs are 3.0 economy, very creative, amazing. And in Spain, it happens that, as you know, the best chefs in the world are from Spain right now. So since many years, we are beating the French. I mean, if you take the rankings of the restaurant, during years, Ferran Adrià, El Bulli, was the number one worldwide. Right now, you have three brothers, Roca, from also the north, Catalonia, that are number one. The only chef that remained 10 years after Ferran Adrià in the top 10 worldwide is a chef from the Basque country called Andoni Luis Aduriz, from Mugaritz, from the north also. So you have a huge boom of food and very sophisticated techniques that came from Spain. The Spaniards is very different from the French, to put it that way, because simply they came after and they have to catch up with all the the tendencies, all the influences worldwide. So they have been listening, cooking, digesting, incorporating influences from Asia, from Latin America, from Middle East, from all across Europe, etc. And there's a chef, it's called Paco Morales, he's 34 years old, is already one-star Michelin. Probably he will get more stars. I mean, he's a top one. And he spent the last 3-4 years revisiting all the Al-Andalusi Muslim Arab presence, gastronomic presence of the 700 years in Spain. So it's a journey towards the past, and he was reborning all this tradition. What I love with this project, it's called Noor. The restaurant will be open in 1 month, exactly 1 month, 3rd of December in Cordoba, south of Spain. And it's a cultural project because he said, okay, during 700 years, he's from Cordoba, I've been living in a city that was known in Europe for being the enlightenment, the light of Europe. It's the first city in Europe that had light during the night. That's why he used the name of Noor for his restaurant, the first city. In Europe, this is not always well known. All the philosophy of Seneca, Aristoteles, are known and were saved by the Muslims that were in Cordoba, the philosophers, Averroes, Avicennes, Maimonides. So there's huge cultural concentration that was going on in Cordoba. And by the way, it was also a lesson for humanity because Jews, Muslims, and Christians were living in the same city, and they have been living there for 100 years, nicely, until the Christians from the north came. They kicked off the Muslims and invaded Cordoba, and they decided that everything related with the Muslim world, Arab world, should be undercover. So that's why the Mosque of Cordoba, in the middle of the mosque, you have a Christian church, which is crazy, but that's the case.
It's a strange sight.
Yeah, it's very impacting anyway. The mosque is beautiful, and the church is there also. So Paco Morales say, if we have this history, why not to reborn this gastronomy? When the Christians arrive in Cordoba, they invade and size the city. Obviously, everything related with the Arabs, the Muslims, was forbidden. But the people from Cordoba kept on cooking, using the techniques, etc., the dishes. And this is what Paco Morales has been doing. He has been working with 6 specialists, archaeologists, historians, sociologists, revisiting all the dishes. And this is why it come. And I'm ending with this. This will be the first star Michelin in continental Europe, certified halal. You will have a halal menu. And what I like is, again, the cultural project that is behind. You reborn, you revisit the past, and you project toward the future. Thank you.
Wow, a lot of stuff there. That's very interesting. I mean, I want to come back and revisit some of these ideas about why are these opportunities getting missed, and what is it about Europe and the US, but Europe in particular, I think there's a strong Muslim population, and a lot of opportunity, I think, has been missed. We've got 3 Europeans, so we can have some views, but I think also some other views on why these opportunities get missed would be interesting. But let's move on to our final speaker. Marcos Jank, Vice President from BRF Asia Pacific. This is arguably the largest chicken company, one of the largest food corporations in the world. And we're going to hear from them. Now, just give them a welcome round of applause, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you to the World Islamic Economic Forum for this invitation. Let me talk very briefly about BRF. BRF is a company that has 70 years if we consider Sadia, and 80 years if we consider Pedigão, which is these 2 brands that you are saying here. And these 2 brands were merged in 2009. This is the number 1 and number 2 brands of food in Brazil, and it's one of the largest players in the world market. Today we are the number 7 in terms of market cap in the world if we consider food industry. So we are the 7th largest food industry in the world. And the main reason that we have this position is because in the last 40 years we've been developing international markets. It's a fully integrated company from farm to fork, as we like to say. So we are controlling the whole food chain since the feed that the animals that are for the animals until the retail. So we are talking about farmers, processors, processing, for the processing distribution, so control of the food chain in Brazil and in other countries. The company is today exporting to 125 countries, and we are the number one exporter of poultry in the world with 20% of the market. At the same time, we've been developing especially the market of the Middle East in the last 40 years. We started in Middle East in 75, exporting chicken to Saudi Arabia and to other countries in the region. And this is by far our first market. As you know, it's very difficult to produce chicken in Middle East because of the conditions, natural conditions. And that's why our company has been specialized in halal poultry to Middle East. But now we are expanding to other regions. We are also a very big player in Europe. We are expanding in Africa, as you see here, in Latin America. And our big challenge today is Asia. We just moved part of the company to Asia. We have offices in Japan, China, Korea, and Singapore. So one of the targets for us is to think about the importance of halal in Asia and to continue the growth that we saw in the last years. Just to explain, a company like this is a very big company. We are the largest buyer of corn and soy in Brazil because we use this to feed chicken. Then we have 14,000 contract farmers working with us in a very integrated way in terms of sanitary and productivity and control of the process, because this is one of the issues in this sector is to control the quality and the safety of the food. We have 34 units in Brazil, 11 units overseas, and today our best plant, I will talk about this plant a little later, is the plant in the Emirates, which is in our vision the state-of-the-art plant today, which is receiving feedstock, receiving raw materials from Brazil, but exporting to many countries in the region. We have distribution centers, and we reach 160,000 points of sales every day in Brazil and more than 120 countries in the world. This is the plant in Abu Dhabi. It was launched last year. It's receiving frozen raw material from Brazil. Chicken, turkey, beef, mainly chicken. And we are producing around 100 different products, halal products, to the region, to the Middle East countries, exporting a little bit to other regions, but right now most of the products goes to the region. To distribute these products, we have today distribution companies in Emirates, in Saudi, in Kuwait, and in Oman, creating investments and jobs. And the idea is to have this fully integrated supply chains, which means that we are controlling the whole food chain from the production of the chicken in Brazil to the final consumer, to the retail sector in Saudi or in Kuwait or in Egypt or in Emirates or in all the countries of the region. So this model is part of what we want to do here in Asia, is to develop this idea of fully integrated supply chains in Asia, looking the potential of Asia. And one of the big potentials in Asia is to consider the halal markets in the region, not only in Middle East, but also in India, in China, in Indonesia, in Malaysia, in all the countries that have huge Islamic populations. And there's one reason to do that and to think about that. Asia represents this area that we are seeing over there. Okay, I don't know if I can show. This area that is under the circle. has 21% of the world population. So there is more people inside this circle than outside of this circle, which makes a huge concentration of population in a very small area, less than 10% of the area. Only 18% of the available land, only 23% of the water. So we have a lack of natural resources in an area with a huge population, and a population which is increasing because of the urbanization process, the increase in per capita income, the growing population. So there is a space here for investments in fully integrated supply chains. And there is a space to think about the size of the halal market in this region. And this is probably one of the big challenges we have in the next years. The problems that we face as a big company that started in Brazil, far away. Brazil, as you know, is on the other side of the globe, if we consider where we are today. But we've been expanding, and today we are leader in Middle East. We are the leading company in chicken in Middle East. And what's the big challenge to develop the Asia market for halal products? The first challenge is that most of the countries are still closed to imports. And I'm not talking about the halal accreditation process. I'm talking about especially non-tariff barriers. Okay, because different of the Gulf countries, where most of the countries are open for imports of food because they don't produce food, most of these countries. In Asia, most of the countries have a large population of small farmers, and in many cases, the restrictions to export to these countries are still very important. So the only countries which are open for us in Asia are Japan, Singapore, and Hong Kong. The red countries here are completely closed to exports, like Indonesia, for example. We cannot export chicken to Indonesia, or India. India has very high tariffs, 100% the tariffs to enter with chicken in India, which makes it impossible to export. And the yellow countries are countries that are open, like Malaysia, like Vietnam, like China, but the process to approve plants to enter these countries are still very slow and takes a lot of time, which makes that this is the first problem to be, let's say, a halal company in the region, is that the frontiers are not open and there is still a lot of restrictions in terms of the frontiers. The second is the halal process, because there is no globally recognized halal certification standard. We are still in the process of trying to develop a global standard. Tomorrow we are going to see a panel here about that in the morning, if I'm not wrong. But there's still many different certifications, which are, some of them has a lot of tradition, like, for example, Jakin in Malaysia. But they are not, in some cases, regional or global. If we go to several countries like we do, we are a company exporting to 125 countries today. We needed to follow many different certifications in many different countries, which makes sometimes difficult to think about a global halal market when we still have problems of certifications and problems of access, as I told you before. So this is the big challenge. And just to finish, we tried here to put in two axes what's government attention and what's food industry attention. And this was made by Food Industry Asia, which is an association of large food companies in Asia, most of them multinational companies. And I found very interesting this idea because it tries to show what's important for the food industry and what's important in terms of government attention. For example, food security is a very important issue for governments. But for the food industry, something that we are working with. Of course, there's a food security issue in Asia. But for example, today, food safety in Asia is more important than food security in terms of the of the development of the industry. There's a lot of new legislation, a lot of new claims in terms of food safety, especially in terms of the quality and safety of the products. And I would say halal ecosystem. Halal ecosystem is something that, considering that 1 billion consumers are in Asia, okay, out of the 1.6 billion Muslims, means that the halal ecosystem is a key issue for Asia, and we needed to work very hard in this area in terms of the food industry and in terms of the government. Also, big issues are nutrition and health and regulatory convergence, which is the issue of tariff protection, because when I talk there's tariff and non-tariff barriers, it means that we need regulatory convergence. And there are a few initiatives in this direction, such as the ASEAN community, which will help at the end of the year, the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and many others that are talking about regulatory convergence. So, well, we tried here to put together the main issues for the industry today and the importance of the halal ecosystem, especially in Asia countries. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Marcos. You know, I think when we think in those terms and we talk about a halal ecosystem, I think we can see that we're actually quite a long way from having one. What we're seeing is really the potential and the need for it, you know, in terms of harmonized regulatory frameworks and eliminating non-tariff barriers and things like this. There's really a long way to go in terms of developing a genuine halal ecosystem. I'm going to take some questions from the floor, so be ready with questions. And we've got some roving mics, so just show your hands if you want to ask a question. We have someone already. Yes. Go right ahead. Just tell us who you are and give us a nice, clear question or a comment. Well, can we get a microphone? Can we get a microphone here? Is there a roving mic?
Excuse me, I draw your attention, please.
Yes. Hello. Yes, go ahead.
My name is Alia Burhan. I'm from the Egyptian embassy. I just had two small questions. I'm a bit ignorant in this field. I basically thought halal was just something which is slaughtered the Islamic way. And if you're not eating chicken or meat, then everything basically is halal. So is it possible to educate the public about what is exactly halal and what isn't exactly halal? And it also has implications for the medicines. Some medicines they have, what's this thing they use in the sweets? Gelatin. So they have like pork gelatin and that kind of thing. And another thing, is it possible to educate the general non-Muslim public that make like the companies attest kind of what between a halal meat or chicken, like halal beef cut or halal chicken cut, and a non-halal, and they say, oh, okay, this tastes better or this doesn't taste better. Wouldn't that help the industry? Like in supermarkets, in where the normal consumer, because how do we make this accessible to the normal consumer? And my last question, has there been any kind of twinning between the halal industry and the kosher industry? For example, I lived in the U.S., was visiting, and many times I see kosher sausages, kosher hamburgers. So I heard that أكل أهل الكتاب يحل لكم. So this is the food of أهل الكتاب. So it's okay to eat kosher food. So thank you.
Oh, okay, there's a whole load of questions there. We've got another one there, but I think we need to just, because there was three questions there, would anyone like to tackle? We've basically got the idea about the idea of halal just being to do with meat and poultry, and doesn't extend further than that. And then questions on medicine to do with gelatin, and then any parallels or convergence between halal and kosher. Anyone want to have a go at those, Cedomir?
I will be the first one.
Okay.
Let's work. So I think that the question is absolutely right, because the term education here is not formal education, meaning in school or something else. But we are traveling in many countries, and you could be surprised to see how little people know about halal. Would it be in Muslim countries or in non-Muslim countries? So I remember 2006 that Abdalhamid mentioned concerning the first World Halal Forum, and very often we had many candid questions about what is halal, and from mainly coming from Muslim countries. Would it be Central, let's say, Asian countries or some others? They are coming and asking this kind of questions. I think that since that time, we have gone through a long path. So today, the education, or at least information, exists. The only problem is that it is not widespread. The only problem is that it is not disseminated. So very often, you will have people who know, of course, everything about halal, and on the other side, you have masses of population who don't have any glimpse about that. The only thing that they know is that they shun from pork and from alcohol, and that's it. And they don't know anything else. So this is a big problem also for the producers. When the producers come up with products such as halal water, or when they come with some other products, they have problems of acceptance of the public, because the public is not used to this kind of products, and they cannot imagine this. And furthermore to this, the term halal is becoming generic, and we are using it for everything. So it is now becoming a halal way of life, and you're using it for tourism, you're using it for pharmaceuticals, you're using it even for finance. I have many people who call it halal finance instead of calling it Islamic finance. So you're absolutely right. Information exists, but it is not disseminated. So the question is to know who should disseminate this kind of information. Is it a public initiative, or is it a private initiative, especially coming from companies which would be interested in disseminating this kind of information? Mm-hmm. I will let the others also to intervene.
I'd like to answer some of those questions myself as well. You know, this question, it highlights the perceptions of halal in different parts of the world. You know, in Southeast Asia, where you have these multicultural countries, you find that there's a very deep understanding about halal, and a regulated halal industry has been around for a long time. You have non-Muslim food producers, Malaysia, for example, Chinese food producers, Malaysian Muslim consumers. So a certification process got put into place, you know, 30 years ago, so that the Chinese food would be acceptable, Chinese manufactured food would be acceptable to a Malay Muslim population. Whereas in the Muslim majority countries, for years we heard the thing, well, you know, it's all halal, all our food's halal. But what we're now seeing is that the Muslim majority countries, who previously said, well, all our food is halal because we're all Muslim, are now realizing that in order to access international markets, they also need halal certification on their products. And so I can give you an example, actually. There's an Egyptian dairy company called Greenland. And there was an interview recently, and to do a small bit of self-promotion, I've recently just finished a book with the International Trade Center in Geneva. We used the Greenland story as an example in the book, because the head of the company said, I've been in the food business all my life. I've never heard of halal certification. And then they wanted to export to Malaysia, and they were asked for halal certification. They went through the process of getting halal halal certification. Their exports to Malaysia quadrupled. And that was all thanks to halal certification. So a shift in awareness and the addition of what was probably a very straightforward process for dairy products to get halal certification actually opened up a huge export market for them, and they've now exported also to other Southeast Asian countries. So these shifts of perception, the way halal is viewed in different ways in different parts of the world, and in Europe and the United States, again, it's viewed in a different way. It has geopolitical overtones, but it also represents the identity of the Muslim minorities who live there. And also to your question in terms of halal and kosher, there are, of course, similarities. Muslims can eat the food of the people of the book. So in that sense, it's halal in a legal sense. But halal has taken on the meaning of defining a market at this stage, and it's defining a market of the preferences of Muslim consumers. So I would say that in that sense, the meaning of halal, in a sense, has shifted. Its legal definition still exists, but in terms of the role that it plays in the market, it's extended beyond that to really address the consumer preferences of Muslim populations around the world. So that, for example, gelatin in a medicine is something that no one really thought about very much some years ago, whereas now people want to see that there's halal gelatin in their pharmaceutical products. So, and this process of these shifting, this evolution of the meaning of halal as a market parameter is going on all of the time at different speeds in different parts of the world. And this is one of the reasons that the halal market is such a complex and fascinating phenomenon. And I hope that addresses some of your issues. There was a gentleman here. Whoa, okay, we've got several. There was a gentleman who had his hand up. Yes, you've got the microphone already. Shoot, sir.
Hear me? Hello? Yeah,
my name is Muhammad Lakiyatullah. I'm from Bangladesh. What is the advantages of halal food in case of health and nutritional over that of other foods?
What are the advantages of halal food from a nutritional or health perspective? Anyone want to have a go at that? I mean, I would say that's an open question, and I know there are some researchers in different parts of the world who are looking into it. I know in Saudi Arabia there's some research being done. For example, is there less microbial activity? Is there less bacteria, active bacteria, if the animal has been halal slaughtered and then bled? So would it then have a longer shelf life? These are some of the questions that have been raised. But in terms of straight one-to-one, is halal food healthier, is an open question, and I don't think there's a clear answer to that. But it's certainly something that people are looking at, probably from a kind of marketing perspective. They'd like to get an answer to that. But when we know, if anyone knows, I'm sure they will tell you. But
Hi, I'm Petar Galovic, founder and CEO of Arabco Projects, a consulting company from Croatia for Islamic markets.
Just put your hand up.
Yeah, I'm here.
Yes, okay, yes.
With focus on GCC and MENA. So just recently I was attending this World Islamic Economy Summit in Dubai, and there were lots of discussion about standardization. So I would like to ask you, where do you see main obstacles in getting unique halal standard like ISO or AJCCP? And the question for Mr. Nestorovic, how do you see potential of Southeast European companies in engaging in halal market? Also, I would like to use this opportunity to invite you in the World Halal Day in 2016, which will be held in Croatia as a part of 100 years of institutional acceptance of Islam. Thank you.
Obstacles to one halal standard. Would any of our food manufacturers like to talk about the issues around halal standards and the problems?
I would just add that for the standards, we can imagine the two groups of countries, that is OIC countries and non-OIC countries. In non-OIC countries, especially if they come from Europe, usually the state would not like to regulate this. They would say this is a private affair, this is a religious affair, so we don't want to establish one compulsory standard for them. In other countries, such as Australia and New Zealand, they were taking the opposite view. So they are saying, no, we want to regulate it because we want to export. So in that case, we need to have something which is sustainable. But in the great majority of Western countries, they don't want to regulate. So I'm really not optimistic to see very soon that in the United States, in France, or even in UK, that they will come up with a common standard concerning this. Concerning OIC countries, some of them are very much advanced, such as Malaysia, as we already mentioned, or even Brunei, for a comment. But other countries are just discovering what halal is and what is the standard and what is the certification. So probably they will need some time in order to come up to the same level of understanding, and especially to understand what are the market opportunities which are linked with that. And finally, again, we still have those differences concerning the schools of FIC. So the OIC is mandating Turkey, it is mandating the United Arab Emirates in order to come up with something which is common. So they are producing it, but the question is, will all countries accept this kind of thing? I'm not optimistic that in, let's say, 5 years, we will have one common standard accepted by everyone. But things are moving in this direction. If we compare it to the situation of, let's say, 20 or even 10 years ago, we are much, much better today concerning the harmonization than we used to have 10 years ago. We are still far away from this, but things are on the good way for that. Yeah. And one thing concerning the Southeastern European countries, we have witnessed some moves coming, especially from Bosnia and Herzegovina, concerning this market. So far, they did not succeed very well. Maybe, to my opinion, because the marketing efforts were not there. It doesn't mean that the quality of food is not there, but the marketing efforts were not there. Here we are in Southeast Asia, the knowledge about Europe, and especially Southeastern Europe, is very low. So in that case, it's very hard to penetrate the markets. But with the marketing efforts, everything could be done.
Certainly, harmonizing standards is quite a long road. Hyunju, you've had experience with trying to get the KMF standard recognized by other countries. Can you say something about how that experience has been for you?
Well, as I mentioned during
just bring the mic closer.
Yeah. Okay. As I mentioned during my presentation, KMF has currently crossed accreditation with Malaysia. And so in order to export to Indonesia or to other countries, we need to get, you know, that other halal certificate that that is accepted by that country we are trying to export. So I think the harmonization of standardization is really important.
Do you think that that corporations, mm-hmm. large corporations, mm-hmm. can play a significant role in terms of pushing mutual recognition and harmonization of standards, pushing that agenda forwards? For, you know, I always think of the BRC, the British Retail Consortium standard, mm-hmm. effectively was decided by the four major supermarket chains, and the government rubber stamped it. Mm-hmm. And I often wonder whether something like that needs to happen in the halal sector. The standards development agencies and the certifying bodies and the accreditation bodies and the scholars discuss mm-hmm. standards, but actually the people who really use them are the manufacturers. Should there be more engagement from the side of the manufacturers, do you think, in terms of moving that agenda forwards?
Yes, we talk to our government a lot. We need our own standards that is harmonized with international standards so that our industry can use our own standards that is not own standards, but you know, if we have our standards that is harmonized with international standards, we can have our standards to export to other countries so that we can develop the halal industry as a whole.
Have you found there's been a resistance from Korea as a non-Muslim country getting involved in halal? Has there been any resistance from the Muslim majority countries in terms of recognizing your halal certificate?
For that, I really have no idea. I think the KMF, the Korean Halal Certificate Bodies, try to have another, you know, other cross certification with other countries. Yeah, they are trying to expand.
Yeah, because certainly one standard would make an enormous difference to a large exporting company like yourselves or for BRF. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But part of the issue is that countries that don't have halal standards want to develop their own, whereas there would be an argument for saying, well, let's just have one. But rather than going there, everyone is developing their own. So, you know, now Pakistan has traditionally not had a standard. They're developing one. Egypt, you know, Morocco is just working on one. what we're going to see is that we're going to have to go through a phase of national standards, which is probably going to make life extremely complicated for manufacturers. I mean, Marcos, how many different certifications do you need? For you export to 125 countries. Do you know how many different certificates you need?
Yeah, it's difficult to say, but you have the Gulf, Jakin, Mui, ISO. The ISO is just a discussion now. So there's a lot of. But I think the whole issue is how to reduce all the transaction costs that we have when we have so many certifications, because we need a lot of adaptations at the plant level, especially we that we are today making all this lottery process. So for every certification, there are different conditions. And just to answer one of the questions about health and nutrition, I think on the health side, one of the importance of the halal is first, there's no alcohol, no, at all. So this is good for the health. But also the slaughter process, when we eliminate all the blood in a controlled way, since the beginning of the story, was a very important element to control the quality of the meat. The elimination of the blood in a very controlled way, as it was proposed since the beginning. So I think that this is an element of quality, because
in terms of the bleed out,
in terms of the slaughter process.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
So the halal means that you are controlling very strictly the way that you are killing all the birds, and because you are controlling so well, the quality is assured by this system. So I think the fact that there is no alcohol and the fact that there is a very strict control of this lottery process are elements of a better, healthy product in terms of the meat.
Yeah, certainly. I think the medical profession in general would recommend eliminating pork from a diet in order to be healthy, and that it's common across a lot of different religions, and I know certain Christian groups say stay away from pork. So there's one healthy aspect of a halal diet. There were some more hands raised up here. Yes, there's some women. Yes, I can see you. Yes, on the front row there. Exactly, yes. You're live.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I must congratulate the industry player in halal field, because you are doing something, a business set, very noble. I am Melina Wong, formerly a Buddhist, a vegetarian. Eating meat is no-no. Killing is not in our chapter. I become a Muslim 20 years. In my journey, I have learned from the book of Imam Al-Ghazali, in the inner dimension of sacrifice, slaughtering, it's a very noble exercise. The animal should be sacrificed in a very peaceful, harmonious and wholesome way. My understanding in halal is lawful, peaceful, harmonious and wholesome. But it's a whole lot of knowledge that we must learn. For Muslim to appreciate halal with mind, heart, and soul. With non-Muslim to share, you must choose halal, to eat halal, but not forced to accept halal concept. And I think the industry player should pay more importance to tell about the narrative of halal, the definition of halal. And the slaughterhouse or the farm to the table, the whole supply chain should be open data for all to be able to see and learn what is the philosophy of halal. That's my input. And I hope the industry player can, besides just selling and make money, you are doing good job. It's a noble business that must share with the world. Thank you.
Oh, you've touched on a very deep subject there. Would anyone like to respond to that at all? While you're thinking of something, I actually want to respond. This is a very interesting point in terms of the nobility of slaughter. I don't know how many people in the audience have actually slaughtered an animal. I mean, the first time I did it, it almost reduced me to tears. It was a very powerful, profound experience. I slaughtered a sheep. After I'd only been Muslim a short period of time, it was profound. I mean, look, clearly, when you have a food industry, you're not going to have the same depth of attention that you have if someone is slaughtering one animal, an individual slaughtering animal. You have production lines. I mean, how many chickens go through in an hour on your production lines? 5,000, 7,000?
Yeah, could be 5,000, 7,000.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's very important to say that, for example, in our case, that we come from a country which is non-Muslim, we bring all the slaughtermen from Muslim countries. There's hundreds, thousands of expats in Brazil to do this process. There is all the accreditation bodies in Brazil. There is all the control of the way that we are doing the slaughtering. Mm. Including, for example, you have very specific processes that you need to follow. Even in different slaughter bodies, slaughter countries, in different countries, there are different ways to do, and you need to adapt the plant for these conditions. And we are always open to receive visitors. Actually, before coming to Asia, I was in charge of the corporate affairs, and we receive around 300 delegations per year in our plants. So it's a lot
of inspectors
coming. Clients.
People coming to see.
Governments, and of course all the inspectors. Wow. But inspectors are there all the time. If you are doing halal, you need to have inspectors all the time following the process in your plant, and these inspectors come from the certifiers. Okay, but besides that, you needed to hire Muslim people for this lottery, and we are always open for visits because we are receiving, as I told you, more than 300 delegations per year in our plants.
There's more or less one every day. The animal expert, Dr. Temple Grandin in the United States, who's an animal behavior expert and who has designed a lot of the best slaughter lines, particularly for cattle, she determined that if an animal is religious slaughter of an animal which is calm at the moment of slaughter, actually does not realize that it's had its neck cut. In a report that she wrote, it was maybe 20 years ago, she said that there's more response from a cow when you put, you know, the ear tags that they have on a lot of cattle. She said you get more of a shock reaction putting an ear tag in than if you do slaughter correctly, because you would cut the blood supply to the brain almost immediately. Particularly in the West, there's a lot of discussion about whether halal is cruel, etc. And this is one of the issues that the industry in general has to deal with. But the idea of bringing the kind of sacredness back into the whole question of food and the way that halal is marketed, I think, is still very much in its infancy in terms of telling the narrative of halal. It's really, that's only just begun. And in fact, some of the cutting edge work in that respect is being done in the United States and in countries like England, where you've got Muslim entrepreneurs who are very serious about what they do and they want to get it right. And so they make sure that their process is done well. But if you think about how the food industry in general, like the health food industry, how they market their products, and then you look at halal, you can see that there's actually, halal has a long way to go in order to get up to the kind of cutting edge of how these, the kind of eco-ethical elements in the food industry, how they tell their story. And I think consumers these days really like to hear a story. And I think the halal sector, there's a long way to go there, I think. We're kind of just gone over time, but let's have one more question before we, who will it be? I don't know who was first. Do you know who was first? Who's closest to the mic? The gentleman here, yes, no, the gentleman here has been asking, yes. Lucky, last one.
Indeed. Abdelhamid, this is Laurent Marlière from ISFIN. Thank you for putting together such a wonderful panel. I usually fall asleep in most conferences, but here it's just absolutely thrilling and exciting.
It's good to hear.
Thank you for the optimism that's coming out of the conversation. We're slightly coming from Halloween to Hollywood, and that's very optimistic. Since we have on the panel Western professionals, could you address the convergence model? And by convergence, I mean that halal travel and family travel converge. Islamic finance and ethical finance converge. Halal and sustainable development converge. Could you briefly address the value proposal that can be offered to both the Muslim and non-Muslim consumer? Thank you.
Thank you, Lawrence. That's an interesting point. And I actually, this also leads to the kind of closing remarks that I wanted to hear from the different panelists in terms of this element of convergence, I think, is to do with what Halal 3.0 may look like in terms of how these things converge. So I think really just to go through the panel, starting with Cedomir, just get a sense of what do you see, how do you see this kind of playing out in the future?
So, and it is a truly interesting question because if we talk about the ecosystem, in that case, we have to find out how the ecosystem is working and what is at the heart of the ecosystem. So at the heart of the ecosystem is obviously the definition of halal. So again, if we have a restricted definition of halal, which is only talking about meat and meat only, in that case, the possibility of convergence is practically eliminated. On the other side, if we adopt one open definition of halal, which is looking at the halal way of life, in that case, the term halal, which means permissible, but it doesn't mean automatically only meat permissible. Everything can be permissible. In that case, the convergence can come in. And in that case, you can put Islamic finance, you can put travel, you can put pharmaceuticals, you can put insurance, you can put all kinds of businesses because the definition of halal is completely different and it is inclusive, while in the first case, it was completely exclusive. So in the future, if the open definition, if the inclusive definition of halal is getting up, in that case, we can talk about convergence.
Well, very briefly on the convergence question, I think that first, probably, we have to fight the ignorance. Before having convergence, we need to fight back ignorance. And I go back to my Spanish example. I think it's amazing to think about 700 years of history and there's a total ignorance of the halal markets, or the halal economy, or halal opportunities. Less and less, hopefully. That's why on the convergence side, I brought this example of Noor, the chef. I think it's a wonderful, teeny example, wonderful example, but it can have huge media impact. That's why I think it deserves a bit more attention, maybe to tumble the walls of ignorance. And after, obviously, if you look at even the share interest, I mean, it's, again, Spain, there's 2 million Muslims visiting or living in a way or another. So it's not very big, but it's a country of tourism, 65 million. So it's the number two worldwide. Mm. Ignorance makes that you don't have a lot of attention to halal economy. So before convergence, we need to tumble ignorance. Hmm.
Marcos, any
in
comments?
In the case of our company, we started our life in Brazil, but now we are moving to investments in several countries of the world. We already have plants in 7 countries, but we are planning to come to the places where there's a huge potential in terms of the markets, in terms of the need of food, and these are mainly developing countries, and part of these countries are Muslim countries. And the best plant we have today is exactly in Abu Dhabi, the most modern plant that we have today. So we want to continue to follow this idea of convergence, because we believe very much that the halal ecosystem is one of the priorities of companies like ours. And if we have convergence, this will help to create a very robust, a very important market, a very transparent market. So we believe that this is extremely important for us. We are users of this convergence. If it happens, it will be very good for companies like ours.
For the final comment, I would like to say a little bit more about the Korean halal food markets, because in Korea, Muslim population is less than 1%. So it's not really easy to communicate with our Korean consumers what really halal means. And in Korea, there is another interesting thing happens. Our government has revised the current law that prohibits labeling and advertising of halal certificates on their labels. So actually nowadays in Korea, manufacturer can advertising and put halal certificate on their product label as an exemption. So Korean consumers are going to see halal certificate products on in the supermarket shelves, and they are going to wonder what it is, you know. So it is really important to communicate with Korean consumers what halal really is nowadays.
Yeah. And I'm also going to have a crack at that question as well. You know, I think that the last decade, I'm speaking in a way from my own experience, but the last sort of 10 or 15 years, there's been almost an obsession with the legal aspects of the halal sector. How is it slaughtered, standards, certification, all of these issues that are that do represent the kind of foundation of it. And without that, there's nothing. But one needs to move past that, because that isn't the whole thing. That's really just the foundation. It's not the building. And, you know, if you look in the Quran, Allah says, eat what is halal and tayyib, eat what is lawful but wholesome. And I think that there, in around this term tayyib and the wholesomeness, I think that's where the convergence will happen. Because if we look at the other, what I call the eco-ethical movements, particularly in the food sector, but also across all kinds of other aspects of markets in general, particularly in the Western world. People want to see ethical behavior. They want to see morality displayed in the marketplace. And I think we've all had enough of the criminal activities of the 1%, let's say. You know, I think if from the halal market perspective or the halal ecosystem perspective, if we focus more on the shared values and less on the particular Islamic terminology, I think that is where we'll find the common ground. Everybody wants to have things people want truthfulness, they want healthy things, they want fairness, they want morality. These things are deeply human. And they're embedded in halal and tayyib. Those things are embedded there. And I think the onus to make the convergence happen, the onus lies on the Muslims to really explain what it is that we're doing without falling over our own terminology and explain, you know, this is marketing 101. I remember years ago, Lever Brothers talking about selling washing powder, saying don't sell washing powder, sell clean shirts. Everybody wants clean shirts. No one wants to do the washing. Sell clean shirts. And I think halal has to follow down a similar kind of path. We have yet to really market it on its benefits, not just the food, the whole element in terms of family-friendly travel. Even now, you've got media companies who are coming up and they're offering film and television content, which is it's family-oriented. It has Islamic sensibilities, but it's not shoving religion down anybody's throat. And I think this is where the zones of convergence are going to lie, because if we recognize that we're one human race, and that what has been decreed for us divinely is actually good for all of us, and I think the Muslims need to stop trying to own it completely for themselves and actually just give it away to the rest of the world, and then I think we'll see some significant changes. I want to thank you all as an audience. Great questions. Excuse me for the ones that we didn't have time for, and I want to thank all of my panelists here for their astute and enlightening remarks and conversation. And on that note, I'm going to hand back to the MC.